Greetings, everyone. Welcome to THL's Heart Center. This is your Tuesday night show, bringing you a recap of what happened last week. But since there was no last week, we're going to talk about the last week of the season, as well as some other highlights of what is going to happen this season, because the THL season is starting soon. I am Lotus Knight, one of your hosts. And I am joined by, on my left, we have Super Chicken. Chicken, how are you?
I'm doing great, thanks. Yeah, I'm excited for another great season of THL Hearthstone.
For sure. And to the right, we have Geranium Battle. Geranium, how are you doing?
Doing great. The beginning and the end of the season are always fantastic. And we're at the beginning, so let's begin.
For sure. Let's have a crazy show tonight as we're going in to talk about what happened last season in Legacy, Hero, and Pro. And then we're going to go over the trio scenes. We also have the unique once-a-season opportunity of hearing our actual commercial. Yeah, we have a clean commercial today. Neji still hasn't messed it up, so we're going to start our usual corrupted commercial starting next week, so stay tuned to see how that goes. But why don't we take a look at what happened in Hero? So Hero last season ended up with quite the match, and I'm going to ask Geranium Battle to tell us what happened there.
Of course. This would be a great cue for me to open up the notes.
It isn't in the notes, it's on the website. Or in Twitch. But I can also give a quick warm-up. We had the finals between the late bloomers, headed by Always Just in Time, facing Abusing PR Management. So tell us a bit of your highlights, since you were one of the champions, Geranium. Tell us how that whole end of season in Hero felt for you.
Man, if we're talking about the whole end of season, it was struggle after struggle, because as you would think in playoffs, every single team that made it there was extremely strong. So we somehow beat Department of League Administration. We somehow beat IceCon Citadel, and then maybe the late bloomers were high on their laurels after coming off of fighting F12 Obsidian, so maybe sucker punched them a little bit and stole that win, and I'm happy for it.
Nice. Any particular moments that showed Hero fun for you for last season?
Yeah. I mean, there were quite a lot of sweeps. I think last season, there was an entire format where Demon Hunter, whether your Demon Hunter beat their Demon Hunter, sort of decided the match. And I think that part of the season was very fun, of even just exploring, like, what can we do to counter Demon Hunter more directly. So I thought exploring that was very interesting.
For sure.
Yeah, I actually really enjoyed the Hero meta kind of for that reason. I think it was Justin who kind of, like, Always Just in Time that got me on this. But I found Warrior as a fourth class in Hero last season to be really fun when Demon Hunter was really strong. Because, yeah, Warrior did really well into Demon Hunter, the kind of 30-card control Warrior, at least. Because you kind of just played no minions and had, like, a bunch of armor gain and had, like, more than 30 damage in your deck. So most of the time you were able to just kill the Demon Hunter over the top, and yeah, it served as a great way to kind of deal with the Demon Hunter, and then yeah, I had a couple good matchups into other decks as well.
It's an interesting format when Warrior, which arguably has been pretty bad ever since Naga time, actually did pretty well because you hit some key matchups. Anything else anyone wants to mention about the Hero season before we move on to talk about Legacy?
Yeah, I had my personal best hero record last season, so I can't wait to follow that up with my worst personal hero record this season.
It's true. That does happen a lot. Who's never had a great season followed by like losing every single match? A part of THL.
Yeah, I went like I went like 10-1 in pro one season, and then like went 0-2 my first 2 weeks the next season.
Yep. Yeah, that happens a lot, honestly. But let's keep it going with Legacy, because Legacy had interesting finals with the Clown Stoners facing the return of Dead Legend. What happened there, Chicken?
Yeah, it was sort of a back-to-back for the Clown Stoners. Slightly different team than the season before, having Dankus Dad and Ron Mexico, I believe, in place of Molestar and Canoe, I believe. Mm-hmm. But yeah, I mean, similar team, still very, very strong. Having Molestar in the two seed is pretty absurd. Neji just keeps building these insane legacy teams that win championships. But yeah, Dead Legend was also a pretty solid team as well, especially with the midseason pickup of Based Inc., who ended up doing really well. It was actually undefeated until the finals here, falling 3-0 to Neji. But yeah, really strong run by Dead Legend, who had, I think, a pretty average regular season, but then made a really strong playoff run.
For sure. Geranium, anything you want to add about this one as a captain of one of those teams?
Yeah, I mean, we tried to prepare for a lot going into playoffs. Once again, there were a lot of very strong teams that we were considering fighting. We kind of got very lucky because Copa Keepers, which was the team that beat us during the main season, fell in the first round. And then after that, we looked across the bracket and an Ock to the Future and the season 23 chicken team. I'm sorry, I don't have the full name in front of me, so I can't list it off. But both of those also fell in the first round. And while we were thinking of how to sort of prepare against those closer to finals, then it ended up being sort of a big mix-up. And then there were also some more unique brings that Dead Legend brought to the table in finals. So I think that was a good adaptation sort of season for us.
For sure. Any final comments about Legacy that anyone wants to share for last season?
Yeah. Yeah, it was another season where my team had a good regular season, then flopped in the playoffs. But this season, I assure you, my team will have a great regular season and then not flop in the playoffs. Surely.
See about that. As we move on to talk about,
you're talking up Neji Boston's team building. So, yeah. Sorry. Talk about pro.
This will be my first Legacy season in the two seed, actually. I think Neji is the only player in Legacy with a higher PR than me. So, yeah, it'll be interesting to face some different opponents, because, yeah, I usually end up playing, like, a lot of the same people in the one seed. So be interesting to face off against some new faces.
Yeah, now you won't get to face off against 50 PR players. Sad.
And lose PR for winning 3-1.
Should have won that game.
I should have.
So, with that said, let's move on to Pro, where we had the finals between Chicken Is Down, Just In Time to Clown, and F2L. So, Chicken, why don't you tell us how that went?
Yeah, I think, if I remember correctly, I didn't actually play in the finals because my team had already lost before my match time came up, unfortunately. Yeah, it was like, I think a combination of F2L probably out preparing us in some categories, and then also, you know, a little bit of bad game day luck, and then also a bit of in-game misplays, if I remember correctly. But yeah, it just didn't really go our way. But yeah, credit to F2L as well. They were a really strong team this year. They were the one team in our conference that was really giving us a hard time. And yeah, they played really well in playoffs and in the finals. So big congrats to them. Who was on that team? Rebob, Itachi, Debs, Diamond, and was it Marty? I can't remember who the last. I think it was Marty. Okay, yeah. So yeah, congrats to all of them. Very well played. It was a pretty good season overall. But definitely looking to win it next season.
For sure. Geranium, anything you want to talk about pro here?
Yeah, it was a fun season. It was my sort of first try doing more of like a fuller season of pro. And I had a lot of fun preparing for my opponents. I think that there were quite a lot of good upsets in the playoffs as well for this one. I do remember Chicken is down just in time to clown, sort of thinking that they were going to have to face the punished apes. And then when they faced the APM team, maybe they breathed a sigh of relief, but then it was also a close match there as well. So, and then on the other side, of course, Brushy Tuna, unfortunately falling in semis as well, when I know that they're a perennial finals contestant.
Now, one thing I want to ask you all as I move to the main screen is, what are some highlights of the team you've seen? You've seen teams that are going in this season in Legacy, in Hero, in Pro. So any teams you want to highlight from these series, it can be whatever you want. And I want to start with Geranium. Any teams you want to highlight that aren't yours?
Wow. Just in general, but before I highlight any teams, I do want to note that I think the quality of teams is very high this season. And I am I'm pleasantly surprised, even though I know that a lot of teams are like, they sometimes have PRs that are in the 1700s or even the 1600s. I still think that the quality of players here is some of the highest it's ever been. I was scared that with the announcement of competitive not being looked at, that we were going to lose a lot of competitive players. But I think that a lot of the players that stayed here are the ones that are more diehard into THL and are still looking for a competitive drive. That being said, I think in Hero, I do want to highlight the somewhat hastily improvised team. We do have a little bit of sort of an untested roster here with Maxi Bon, World 8, and Pigpen all being new to Hero, and World 8 being new to THL. But from what I've seen of these players, they are certainly taking standards seriously. They are grinding, and they are going to put their best foot forward. And then Dr. Bombi in the 4 is something that I had the luxury of having back when I started captaining Hero, and he should not be in the 4 seed. So I think that somewhat hastily improvised team, despite the fact that maybe you look at the roster and you don't see those super names, I still think that team is going to go very far, probably even make playoffs.
All right. Chicken, any teams you want to share that you're excited to see?
Yeah, I also want to say that when I saw Bomb D in the 4, I was also very surprised. I didn't know that was possible, because yeah, he plays in the 1 seed in Legacy and he does pretty well. So that, I mean, that somewhat hastily improvised team, I think, will definitely be very, very strong. But yeah, with regards to who I think will do well, I think if this website ever loads, I think the Molestar team is a kind of dark horse to look out for. He's basically assembled, I think, a bunch of UCLA players, and then also his brother. So I really don't know what to expect with this team, but Mole is a very, very strong player. So surely by some sort of transient property, his brother is almost equally as strong, if not stronger.
I mean, the last time we saw a brother pair in THL was obviously, and RoboCats was the other, and they were both extremely strong. So,
yep, that's a championship winning pair right there.
Any further teams anyone wants to share?
I'll mention a pro team since we mentioned One Legacy, One Hero so far. I would like to mention that I think Rocket Powered Glug Girl seems to be the best like fully wild team I've seen put up so far. It doesn't have I think like Seth for Christ on it, but other than that, like every single name that I recognize here has done very well. Like Yo Daddy had the undefeated season in pro a couple seasons ago. I believe he was the one who defeated McBannerface in that season. Lasagna is always does extremely well in EU pro and is always at the very top of ladder, and yeah, from what I've seen of Waluigi time, he's also going to be very competitive. So I think Rocket Power Glug Girl is my replacement for XD, and I'm hoping they do well.
Yeah, am I allowed to mention a Trios team? Are we allowed to do that?
We're going to get to Trios, but if you want to mention another team, you're more than welcome to.
Oh, okay. I was just going to say, Barrel of Monkeys. Yeah, Aquaman, Agent PW, and Taco Cat. We're all like 550 PR players. Like perennial masters tour players, and yeah, generally do pretty well and have also all played in the kind of trios format before in collegiate, so I think that will probably be one of the top teams to watch going forward
for sure. We will get to trios very soon, so we can talk more about trios, but any further teams in Legacy, Hero, Pro, or Trios, really, that you all want to mention before we go to our commercial break? All right.
I think for these sort of team coverages, there's a lot of teams that we could mention, but I think one of the best places to find team coverage is the new Bone Master show that happened earlier this morning. So that'll happen, of course, next week as well, but they focus in much more on these specific teams.
That's true. They had a great job recapping what happened to these teams and talking about what changed in Hero, Legacy. They're going to be doing more predictions than we are. So if you're looking for that kind of content, please watch the Bone Master show. It was great this morning, and the VOD is probably already on YouTube. If it's not, Taco's going to get to it very soon. But let me bring us to our commercial. Yo. Hey there, Twitch viewers. Have you subscribed to Team Heart League yet? Then make today the day to be a league yourself and subscribe to our channel. The subscription enables our team to help cover the cost of operating our website as well as improve the quality of our streams and content to our viewers. If you have an Amazon Prime / Twitch Prime, you can subscribe to the channel for free. Subscribers will get a THL emoticon as well as a lovely THL chat badge. So smash the thumbs up button, keep the notifications on to make sure you catch our team broadcasting live. We appreciate each and every one of you. Special note to our viewers, check out THL's other social media points. Our website, teamheartleague.com. Catch us on Twitter at THL_HS. Join us on Discord, Team Hearth League. The true Hearth legend, Saku, continues to post all of our videos on our YouTube channel. Just search for Team Hearth League to see everything previously recorded. You are, of course, watching us on our Twitch channel, twitch.tv/TeamHearthLeague, or possibly on our YouTube channel in the future. And for all you THL fanatics out there, there are sometimes THL shows every single, most days of the week? You can't go wrong tuning in at any time for some Hearthstone-related content. Now back to the good part. Ka-chow.
Yeah, I was reading through it while you were reading it there, and I realized there were still, like, a couple corrupted things in there that needed to be edited.
There are always some things that we just miss.
The corruption is hard to weed out.
It took me 20 minutes. Yeah,
I do like that. As Azalea is mentioning, ka-chow is now, I guess, a part of the real
ka-chow
commercial.
Ka-chow is not a corrupted term.
No, and the ka-chow has been there for like a very long time, actually. It's been 3 seasons that we didn't move the ka-chow. Even when
Clean, well, yeah, that's it's just because Nagi like doesn't let it go away.
No, well, we decided. I think at some point we had a vote and we decided that the best thing was to keep the ka-chow, actually.
Yeah, it's nice.
It is nice, and it reminds us of what our commercial is about: being unreadable starting next week. So, before we go to trios, I want to ask Geranium, do you want to give us a brief reminder of what Trio Series is?
Of course. So, Trios is a paid to play. So you have to pay the initial $30 in order to play. But then there is the prize pot at the end for the top four teams. So we're going to have this main season of 6 weeks where we figure out which 8 teams are going to go into playoffs. And then once we have those 8 teams, the top 4 will each receive part of that huge cash pot that we've sort of all put into. So 50% of the cash pot will go to the first place team, 30% will go to the second place team, and then 10% will go to each of third place and fourth place. Since I don't believe we're going to have a third place versus fourth place match. But yeah, it is teams of 3 that are going to be in calls with each other, talking about their plays, making going well. And then after your 1 match each week, you sort of move.
It seems like Geranium has cut out. Geranium, can you hear us?
Oh, great.
I could.
Yeah.
It was me or Geranium there.
Yeah, I was trying to figure out the same thing, but then I realized, no, I'm fine.
Yeah, that's how it usually is. Okay. I can repeat if you guys want me to.
Really.
Okay. Yeah, so teams of 3 talking on call with each other. And then if you win or lose, you're going to move up or down the rankings and you're going to fight teams of your match record. So 1-0 teams will face 1-0 teams and so on until there are undefeated teams, in which case you'll face as close as possible.
Nice. So my question is, what are the teams that are actually in trios? I'm going to move so we take a look at them, and we're going to alternate between Chicken and Geranium, telling us what the teams are and a few of their impressions. So, Chicken, tell us about Triple Bros Bash.
Triple Bros Bash. Yeah, so we have Anubinator, Reverb, and Jules, captained by Anubinator. Yeah, these are 3 players that have been playing in THL for at least quite a bit of time compared to how long I've been playing, at least. I think at least for as long as I've been in THL, they've been here for quite a while. So yeah, they definitely have experience with the THL format, and I think they certainly have potential to do quite well.
For sure. And Dranium, tell us about the L Gang.
Okay, the L Gang, captained by Lemur, is Lemur, Low Brow, Low Ladder, and Gimme Lamp. And they're going to try and hand some people some L's. I'm sure they're going to bring some very interesting decks. I've only gotten the chance to face Lemur once, but I know he does try to prep really hard and bring interesting brings. And Lowbrow, Low Ladder, and Gimme Lamp are definitely going to help with that. If you remember, Gimme Lamp faced Yellow Dart, I believe, with a bunch of meme decks last season on stream. So I do know that he can be very creative.
For sure. You know, I'm sad I wasn't invited for the L-Gang. But, Chicken, you talked about this team. Tell us about the Barrel of Monkeys.
Yeah, as I mentioned before, team captained by Aquaman with Agent PWE and Taco Cat, who are all Masters Tour practice partners with each other. They tend to, along with other people, tend to practice for MTs together. They've played at most of the MTs in the past couple of years. They're all 550 PR players, very, very strong, as I mentioned. And yeah, like, I think this, even like not only are they strong players, they're players that know each other really well and then also know the format. I think this will probably be one of the top teams in trios this season.
Nice. Looking forward to see Barrel of Monkeys as they face against Cheesemongers United. Dranium, what is that team?
Cheesemongers United, captained by Pyrolama, has Pyrolama, Not Bamity, and Dr. Bondi, which is the pro team. Cheesemongers United, Not Bamity, and Pyrolama are from there, and they sort of reached across the aisle and picked up Dr. Bondi from his pro team, the OPP. So I think this team has. They're not facing Barrel Monkeys first week. They have a pretty solid roster. We talked up Dr. Bondi before, how he was a one seed in Legacy. I think the consistency of this team is going to be pretty solid.
Nice. And as for our next team, Chicken. Let's talk a little bit about AFG.
Yeah, here we have Amber Flight Gaming. We have Based Inc. along with her AFG teammates, Dragon Rider and Azalea Akari. Dragon Rider generally playing in the 3-4 seed in PR'd series, and Azalea Akari, I believe, usually playing the 4-5. While Based is a 550 PR player that plays in the one seed and used to play on Brushy Tuna, but now plays on a different pro team. I forget what the name of her new team is.
But, F2L.
Oh, yeah, right. She's just on F2L. one of the lesser known teams. Maybe one day they will really break through and win a championship. But maybe. But yeah, with regards to AFG, I think these are players who probably get along pretty well. They're all teamed together. I believe they've teamed like in THL in the past as well. So I think this trio makes a lot of sense for them. Dragon Rider and Azalea Akari, I think not on paper, obviously, like, aren't like 550 PRs or anything like you saw in Barrel of Monkeys. I think the fact that they probably work quite well with Based, and like the fact that they have Based to kind of, I guess, lead the team, I think the team as a whole will do pretty well going forward.
Sure. And Dranium, speaking of F2L, okay. Tell us about the next team.
Well, that's not F2L. That's F3L, not to be confused with the pro team of the same name. But as we were talking about Based being a part of F2L, this is a lot of the rest of the F2L team. So Lee Bobson captaining, Marty B on the team, Chewy as well. That's three of the five members from F2L and Pro. And yeah, I mean, these guys really take it seriously. I expect them to go quite far. I know that Ree Bobson and Marty B do work very well together. Chewy is newer to the cast, but he's probably going to, well, hopefully he doesn't provide the bad draw RNG that he usually does. Hopefully he just provides the good play adjustment.
For sure. Now, Chicken, tell me about the One Amalgam Band.
Yeah, this is another team with Copa and Nice Jewish Owl, and this time they are playing with Hustle. Copa and Milo have kind of been teammates on a lot of different teams over the past year and change, playing on pro teams together, playing on maybe like Legacy and Hero. But yeah, they are two players that have really been enjoying teaming with each other, and I've seen a decent amount of success. Actually, they made a pro finals about a year ago, and they've had some really strong regular seasons in Hero and Legacy as well. And Hustle is a player that I think is certainly a lower PR than he should be. He's the 4 seed on my Legacy team this season, and I don't know. Like, certainly from his results, he probably should be higher than a 4 seed at least. Or I think he could, like, in the next coming seasons, he could just gain a ton of PR, move up to a higher seed, because certainly a very strong player and probably a player that will end up in a higher seed going forward. So, yeah, One Amalgam Band looking pretty good.
For sure.
Yeah.
And do you believe in Warrior, Uranium?
Before I talk about Warrior believers, I would like to mention that I think Hustle last season lost a bunch of PR because he was one of the unfortunate captains to sort of be hit more hard by the leave of competitive players. His Legacy team just so happened to have a roster that was more affected by it. So I agree that Hustle should not be a 4 seed. Now over to Warrior believers, though. Finzi is the captain with I Am Moon and Panacea. I Am Moon, you may recognize just as Moon from Hero from previous seasons. This is somewhat of an APM team. Stinzy and I Am Moon, I believe, teamed together last season in Hero. And yeah, I mean, I know Stinzy is a very good player. And having played against I Am Moon, I believe them to put in a lot of work as well. So I have never heard of Panacea, but I think this team will do well.
For sure. And Chicken, tell us about Sugoi.
Yeah, we have three of the usual suspects from Sugoi. We have Molsar, we have Cookie Monst, and we have No Glocko. Molstar and No Glocko, I think, have been on Sugoi a bit longer than Cookie Monst, but all three, I think, have been on Sugoi either on or off for the past few seasons at least. So have all teamed together in pro, and yeah, I think that's probably why they thought this team would be successful. And I think they definitely have a pretty good chance at being successful this season. I've definitely seen No Glocko and Molstar queuing ladder the past couple days, so they're definitely getting back into the swing of things. And I imagine Cookie Monst is probably right there with them. So I think if Molstar kind of comes back to his usual form, I think this team will do quite well.
I mean, he did already beat Justin this season.
He did. The Molstar Revenge Tour is in full swing right now, even though he won like 2 series last season. He is getting revenge on people for thinking he fell off.
Nice. And speaking of revenge, tell me about the Big 3 Drain.
not to be confused with Great Big Three, which I'll talk about later, but the Big Three, even though it's not as great, it does have Super Chicken as captain with Diamond and Neji Boston joining him. And yeah, I mean, this team is a super strong team. Super Chicken and Neji, you know, as being the one and two of a lot of teams this season. And I expect them to do very well. Diamond has also been proving himself in every series. I think he'll continue to do that here. And I think he will also make the environment, the vibes between these players really gel very well, which is the other thing that lets teams win championships. So,
for sure. Now, Chicken, let's take a look at Markman and the Funky Bunch.
Yeah, I'm more familiar with the non-Markman players on this team, Eternal and Judo Chop, who have been around THL for quite some time now. I think, well, Judo Chop's been around for a long time, Eternal a little bit less so. But yeah, these are three players that I assume all have. I'm not too sure about Markman, but yeah, Eternal and Judo Chop definitely both have THL experience. And I'm not sure if they have teamed before. I'm not sure if this was a I'm just looking for any trios team kind of team, or if this was planned out by them. But yeah, it looks like a fun team. Vibes will be good, and I think we'll see a couple of big wins from this team down the stretch.
I will mention that Eternal is slightly older in THL than Judo Chop, and I know this because both of them started on my team. So I think the reason they haven't really teamed before is because two 250 PR players generally don't end up teaming on the PR side of things. But I think that this will be a fun time for them.
I did try to make a 3 550 PR players team work at one point, but it was a little bit too hard to plan. But had we gone for it, this Eternal and Judo Chop perhaps would have been our 4 and 5 seed.
It is the quintessential 550 dream is to have a triple 550 team and have a 550 play in the 3 seed. But as someone who's tried it, like every single season, it's so hard to pull together. And you just give up in the end, I think, every time. We've gotten close, but not exactly there. But speaking of carried players, let's take a look at two carries, one Mako Geranium.
Yeah, I mean, speaking of triple 550 teams, you definitely won't find that here, because as it says in the team name, there are only two carries and one Mako. Captained by two-star Mako, it has Ron Mexico and DeSharmo as the supposed carries. And yeah, I don't think there's really any carries at all, as we've seen Mako do very well in other series. I suspect that the play levels will be quite high among all the people here. I know Mako generally brings different things from Ron and DeSharmo, so that's, I think, where he will shine, is he has more knowledge in those areas than they would. Whereas Ron, you know, really brings the Hunter and Demon Hunter. I think there's third and fourth classes sometimes. But yeah, I think the team dynamic will work well.
Yeah, this team has the reigning Hero Series MVP. And it also has Ron Mexico on this team.
Now, Chicken, why don't you tell us about the Raiders of our Lost Spark?
Yeah, this is a funky little team. We have he would self-describe himself as this, but also something I would definitely call him, the ladder terrorist known as Dankus Dad, that enjoys very long games and wasting everyone's time.
Yep.
And then we have a Legacy 1C champion, Wild 9, and Max is also here, too. How did Max end up on this team? But yeah, this team looks pretty fun. It's got some strong players as well. Yeah, I don't have too much to say. You know, if you're watching the show, you probably know at least two of the players from this team. Or I've at least heard them talk before. And yeah, I think I've talked with Wild Nine a couple times before. He's pretty nice to talk to as well, and he's a very solid player. So I think, yeah, this team will be a good vibes environment.
For sure. Now, Geranium, tell us about a Wild team.
Okay, the Lean Lovers, captained by Waluigi Time, with Maxibon and Lasagna, has a lot of the team that I just talked about before being a really good pro team. Waluigi Time and Lasagna join up here, and then Maxibon, who you might not think is generally being a standard player. Usually he just goes completely undefeated 4-0, 12-0 in the first 4 weeks of Wild. But no, he's actually doing well in standard as well. So I think because these guys have that sort of practice of teaming up and really thinking more about Wild, I think that they will come over and do the same with standard. And I think this is another very scary team to fear, along the likes of the Big Three and Barrel of Monkeys.
Now, Geranium, tell me about a team that does not feature Nine Eyebrows.
Oh, okay. The Ape Men.
Sorry, it is Chicken.
Yeah, we have the Ape Men. In pro, you know them as Shed Ape, Punish Shed Ape, many other Shed Ape monikers. But yeah, it's Heatshock, Ufric, and C-Mac. Three players who have teamed together for over 2 years at this point in Pro Series, and are taking their talents all the way over to Trios. Heatshock, pretty notorious for bringing hard counter lineups. Do with that information what you will if you are against him. And yeah, Ufric and C-Mac sometimes bring some pretty funky decks as well. So this team, I think, is going to be pretty tough to play against for the vast majority of this season.
Yeah, it's quite possible. So our first week, my team's first week, is versus the Ape Men. And as you were saying before, Dangst is a ladder terrorist. I think Heatshock is a THL terrorist, so... this is definitely one of the worst matchups we could hope to have for either side.
For sure. Heatshock is always so scary, but tell me about the better Big Three. What is going on there, Geranium?
Well, this great Big Three here is a reference to a Nova Scotian band or something. That's what Saku seems to be very proud of. I don't know anything about that, but I do know about Yaxter, Wengor, and Corodon. Yaxter, I've had the supreme displeasure of having to face in Hero a bunch of times. And he's knocked my clock around. So I think Great Big Three is actually looking pretty great.
So this is a play on the band originating from Newfoundland, Great Big C. Little Canadian thank heritage you. Moment.
Thank you very much, Chicken.
No problem. Any more Canadian trivia, you can come straight to me.
Yeah, who was the first Prime Minister of Canada?
We will never know. Someone who has been removed from the Canadian currency.
Well, what about our next team? which is the cooler Trios version chicken.
Yeah, we have the Chicago-based Millennium Force Hearthstone team, the cooler, but it's not the cooler. But it is still captained by the Iceman himself, Icer. Yeah, so this, I don't remember if Moon was on the team, but the cooler did win Legacy back in the Alterac Valley THL season. And in
Moon was on that team.
Okay.
Because that is T-Skillet.
Oh, okay. Now I understand. Yeah, everyone loves a good T-Skillet inclusion on the team. Do not ask how much PR he should have. But yeah, CPIC 1 normally plays in the one seed on that team. Icer kind of floats around in like the 2-3 seed. And yeah, this is definitely one of those kind of, definitely one of the those like teams that is like pretty solid on paper, but probably will have most of it or a lot of its strength in how well the players know each other and how well they work together, which I think will probably be like, I think just in general in trios will probably be a difference maker for a lot of teams where they might be just a really strong team on paper, but won't be performing as well as some other teams that just have really good chemistry together. And I think this is one of those teams that does have really good chemistry.
For sure. And as for our final team of the night, Geranium, tell us about the Sussy Union.
I feel like I'm going to do a disservice to them. Sussy Union is the Arizona State University team that normally always plays with Chicken, so he knows more about them. But You Kitten Me is captaining with Skirt Reynolds and Tab. They played in the tournament and did okay. I think that they definitely feel like they could have done better, but that's what they're looking to do. I think that they work very well together. They literally are on the same collegiate team, and yeah, they have been doing quite well with that. So I think that that skill will transfer over a lot better.
Okay. I called Millennium Force a vibes team. If there is one vibes team in the whole of Trios tournament, it is a Sussy Union. I think like Skirt is what one of the most like positive, like easygoing, happy-go-lucky people I've ever talked to. He's just like always super chill, super, super fun to talk with. And then like Tab and You Kitten Me are very close behind him as well. So I think regardless of how well this team does, they will just be having a great time.
Awesome. And with all these in mind, that is it for our Trios teams. For this season, I want to ask Chicken and Geranium, are you excited for Trios?
Yeah, absolutely. I think having a unique format like this is always really cool for THL, seeing what teams come together and what teams perform well in a different format like this. I think it's just going to be really cool to see how things shake out.
For sure. Geranium, anything you want to say?
Am I excited for Trios? No. If my team wants to make playoffs, we have to win. And if we have to win, we are facing just an absolute gauntlet of teams. Why are these teams so good? We face Ape Men the first week, which is, as I just talked about, the terrorism. And then as far as I can tell, if adjacency keeps up, we'll be facing Molestar and then be facing Barrel of Monkeys. So it's really looking to be like a great season. Great. It's just great.
Nice. That's awesome. I'm glad you're excited for the season because we have a lot to talk about over the next few weeks. We do have one final question for the night, which is, this has been a fairly slow expansion. I think a lot of decks are just old decks. There isn't a lot from Festival of Legends, and My question for you all is, do you think the sentiment is true? Or do you think there's room for change? What is actually going on in your views? And I'll start with Geranium here.
Sorry, could you repeat the question?
So some people say, for our checker question, the question is, some people are saying this is kind of a low power expansion, that not much is happening. So my question to you is, do you think that is true? And a lot of Festival of Legend cards aren't going on. Do you think that can change? How do you see it?
Okay, I didn't understand how that connected with the how it's phrased in the notes. I think it's interesting. I think that they focused less on star standout packages and more on accentuating what classes already sort of do well. But in doing that, what they're doing is they're sort of saying, okay, these past formats, these decks that were doing well, where they're going to continue to do well. So if you were sort of bored by those past formats, this is kind of evoking the same thing. And I'm not entirely too sure how to feel about that, because that means that a lot of these Festival of Legends cards aren't getting put in, but it also means that you're not seeing those, 10% higher drawn win rate cards as much, because the cards are sort of lowered on the curve. I think that, early on in the expansion, it's a little too early to tell how people are feeling about it. I'm scared that people will get tired of seeing like Relic DH again and seeing Blood Decay and seeing all of our old friends, but I'm having fun, so.
Nice. And Chicken, how are you feeling so far?
Not too bad so far. I do think, the fact that, I don't know, five out of the six best decks in the game are from last expansion is a bit sad. I guess it kind of, I think pretty big oversight last year was releasing a class in the last expansion of the year when the power level was the highest, and then the class gets balanced around a time when the game is at its highest power level, and then the class doesn't lose any cards at all except for Bran. So it just stays at a really high power level, and then you have you just have two of three or four best decks in the game are Death Knight now. Which I wouldn't mind if Death Knight was really strong still. I think the fact that it's the same decks is kind of boring. And some of the other good decks are really similar. Last expansion we had Attack Power Druid. Oh look, this season we also have Attack Power Druid and Relic Demon Hunter and Pure Paladin and Miracle Rogue. Okay. We have one new deck that is good, and it's Outcast Demon Hunter, which is a cool deck. But yeah, it's a little bit sad when one out of the seven good decks is new and the rest are pretty old. I don't know. I generally prefer it when the game is at a higher power level, because doing things that feel broken is just feels more unique and fun.
Yeah.
So, I don't know, I wouldn't really want to see tons and tons of nerfs. I would, honestly, a round of buffs would be fun. I don't really like the Rifts package either in Warrior. It feels like Relics in Demon Hunter, where, if you buff that, it'll just be, draw your Rifts in the mulligan, and if you don't, your deck sucks, and if you do, the deck's broken. But I would certainly like to see some buffs for the lower win rate classes like Warrior and Hunter and whatever, a Shaman and Warlock and stuff like that.
For sure. That's fair. I would like to see some more original decks, but maybe there are decks we just haven't found out yet. So send us your recipes if you have any. But with that said, from Hearth Center, we want to wish you all a good night. I want to give a special thank you to Chicken and Geranium for hosting with me tonight. It's always great having you. And a special thank you for Bone Masher for his brand new show, which was amazing this morning. Check it out next week. We are going to have match shows. If you want to play on stream, DM Saku, DM Wild9, they are looking for matches. And we will see you next week. Have a good night, everyone. Collaborate.